So my name is Paul. I am married to Jo, and we've been married for almost 8 years now. We live in the northern suburbs, two dogs, one cat, and yeah, that's our little family at the moment. I'm an actuary by profession, but I've only spent a year and a half in the industry. My first real gig was in educational technology for 5 years, and then moved over to financial technology for low-income workers, or financial health for low-income workers supported by tech. And recently in 2020 September, I moved over to Redemptive Capital, a small investment fund co-founded by three of us, including myself. And we invest in companies that promote the flourishing of low-income South Africans. Essentially, healthy accountability is accountability that allows you to be the real you, the you that God designed you to be, and the world to be the world it was supposed to be. In other words, healthy accountability is that which allows you to flourish with regard to your creational mandate, your gospel mandate, and then your discipleship mandate. Most of us think about flourishing as being able to be more free. I think that is a typical Western mindset, but what you see from the Bible and just in nature as well, you flourish most when you've got the right set of restrictions. An easy example is a fish may want to fly, but ultimately it's most free in water. And so we don't often think in that way, but that's actually what leads to true flourishing for us as humans. And the first restriction, or the main restriction that applies, is we were created. And as you see in the Garden of Eden, we dumped that restriction, and then all sorts of issues and horror came from that. We kind of just already addressed the importance of accountability and it's tied to flourishing. So the next question is really, what is business's role in all of that? So kind of starting from first principles, we see that work is a key ingredient to, or key part of, the creational mandate given to us. We see that in Genesis 1, 27 to 29. Furthermore, if you tie that idea up to the idea of loving our neighbor being the most, or part of the greatest commandment that we have, interesting side story is Jesus gets asked that question, and he doesn't say just love the Lord with all your heart. He answers with two answers. And I think he does that because you can't divorce the two. If you love your Lord with all your heart, you're going to love your neighbor as yourself. And then in 1 Thessalonians, you see kind of a tie-in together that work is an expression of love. In 1 Thessalonians specifically, work is how we love our neighbors. So that's just the basics. Then we get to business, and business is ultimately a multiplier of work. It allows us to get greater input for a limited number of inputs, or the same number of inputs. And you can tease it out quite easy. Imagine if all of us had to build, grow our own food, build our own cars, derive our own internet, we literally just wouldn't get anywhere. You can imagine that there's no way that we would get from a garden to a city without something like business as a multiplier of work. I think there are a couple of layers to think through. So your first layer is going to be vision, mission, and values, and that really needs to be mapped out in conjunction with what the Bible says about God's kingdom. Ultimately, if we believe that the Bible is news, not just a story, then we read something like Revelations and even the Gospels, seeing that as fact. It will happen. God's kingdom will happen. And if God's kingdom will happen, then what are the characteristics of God's kingdom? And so anything that doesn't fit into the characteristics of God's kingdom will be demolished. And those that adhere to God's kingdom will flourish and stand the test of eternity. So as we determine our vision, mission, and values, we need to make sure that it is consistent with God's kingdom. Otherwise, it won't stand the test of time. We go from something theoretical, as opposed in the Bible, to something that's more concrete for our business. That business's specific mission, vision, and values. And then you move on to the people structure. That's why you have a board, a management team, you've got an executive team, leadership team, and you've got your employees. And there, each one of those has a different role in bringing forth the vision, mission, and values. You need to equip each one to be able to safeguard the right level of the vision, the implementation of the vision, mission, and values in the company. Often, I think, in a context like that, employees are overlooked. They're told what to do, but employees often are the best people to give you feedback on where you're breaking your vision, mission, and values and how you need to course correct. You've established your guardrails, you've established the people that are going to be responsible for those guardrails, and then you have your rhythms. And that's why we have board meetings, you have strategic meetings, you have operational rhythms. And all of that is an opportunity to take a step back and reflect on that level of the business that requires reflection. You've also got external reverberation, so that's within the company, and then outside the company, how are your service providers responding to you? How are your clients responding to you? How's the general ecosystem responding to you, including things like the environment? If you are hurting the environment and you're starting to see that, then putting two and two together, what you're doing to the environment is resulting in its degradation. And that's also a sense of, there's also a sense of accountability there. That's just within the business context, and obviously all of us are individuals as well. And if we feature inside a business, we need to hold ourselves accountable as well in order to flourish within a business setting. And for yourself, there's friends, family, church. And I love church because church is probably the only imposed, committed accountability that you have. Friends you choose typically. Family you are usually biased against. Dad always operates that way, or mom always operates that way, and then you kind of ignore that. But church is an interesting space where you've got a committed set of brothers and sisters who will, in effect, impose their accountability on you, and you can't run away from it. I try and remain accountable through a variety of means and relationships. So I think first and foremost, my partners at Redemptive Capital keep me accountable for the vision, mission, and values of the work that we adhere to. And often there's also an opportunity to course correct the vision, mission, and values back to what we think the Bible says. But if those are intact, then they will keep me accountable, and they have kept me accountable on many occasions. And then in my personal life, we're quite big on commitments. So Jordan and I are committed to a couple of groups. So the first is life group at church. And that's just been so fantastic to see how the group has flourished because a core set of couples have just committed week in, week out just to be there, no fancy footwork, and somehow that creates just an amazing environment for flourishing. Commitment is not the only thing that you need. You obviously need vulnerability, no kind of sense in just rocking up every Wednesday and not really dealing with the issues. Being vulnerable allows people to see the real you and give you feedback on the real you. If you're not willing to be vulnerable, you give off a fake version of yourself, and then the wrong feedback comes in, which you then can't process correctly because it's not responding to the real you. So accountability has helped me a lot, and in ways that you wouldn't expect when you're going through that accountability. Typically, accountability is not fun. It usually is hitting you hard in an area that you feel defensive about or sensitive about. So for a long time, I have always been more of a left-brained operator, very rational. Seeking to be objective. It was often a defense mechanism against the roller coaster ride that entrepreneurship can be. I'm not the one people come to celebrate. I'm not the one that people come to be excited with. I'm the guy that you call when things are breaking down. And so that's been my leadership style. And unfortunately, that doesn't work if that's the only hat you can wear. People do want to celebrate. People do want a well-rounded person. People want a gentle leader and a kind leader. And for a long time, I tried to figure that out on my own accord. I hired a coach to help me want to celebrate more and all of those things. But I had to cancel it after a couple of months because it just wasn't working for me. So I had the desire, but I couldn't bring it about. And then last year, I think we reached the pinnacle of the impact of my negative or my one way of doing things. And it led to a fractured leadership team, which led to a serious discussion with my partners. It was a grueling 2 hours. And yes, at the same time, some of the weaknesses that I had were laid bare, and they committed to walking the journey with me to figuring that out. But at the same time, true accountability also allows you to recognize what is good, what is being done well. It's not just a blame game. And as a result of that, last year, May, June, I think that's when it happened, I feel like I've become more well-rounded as an individual. So some of the incorrect assumptions about accountability are that perhaps that it doesn't matter on an eternal perspective. I say that because I think, especially for Christians, we're brought up on a diet of Jesus has saved once and for all. And yes, that is 100%. There's nothing we can do to earn our way into God's good books or the book of life. Jesus has done that, and all we need to do is accept. Unfortunately, that is not the only story. The second part of the story is that there will be a second judgment day to speak, and it will cover everything else that we've done with our life. And the best part of that is that as a Christian, there's only upside. So because of what Jesus has done for us, I think about it from an incentives perspective. It happened. It's a very interesting dual incentive model. On the one hand, you've got you're always accepted. You are 100% assured. You don't have to work your way into the family anymore. But the second part of it is the more and more you become like part of the family, the more and more you will be rewarded like part of the family. And I think that's something that's missing. You see a lot of people kind of just seeing this as a binary function. You know, are you saved by Jesus or not? And the rest really doesn't seem to matter, but it matters a lot. Other things are maybe perhaps objective accountability. And I think that's because people miss that there will be a final day of reckoning. And so all other subtypes of reckoning or accounting or accountability need to be referenced to that. So you're not just keeping someone accountable based on your subjective views. If you're going to hold someone accountable, you've got the heavy task or the heavy responsibility of making sure that you're keeping that person accountable relative to what the final accountability day would be. Everything else is in just your opinion. And you know, you can give your opinion, but that's not the true accountability that will take place. So biblical verses that I have found attractive, Revelations 20, 11 to 15, and 1 Corinthians 3, 10 to 15, and it really speaks to what I just spoke of in the previous question, which is that there is a second day of judgment. And it's there because intuitively I felt that a binary way of looking at Jesus and rewards and accountability, it just didn't make sense to me. So if you think of that way, you kind of think, oh, I need to do this because I love Jesus. And that only takes you so far. There's a sense where as an entrepreneur, you want to build things and you want to be rewarded for it. And the reward can be monetary, but it can also be rewarded in the sense that you can do more. You can serve more people, you can build new products. And so the verses or the passages in Revelations and 1 Corinthians does speak to that. Yes, you get through. 1 Corinthians specifically speaks about, you know, building a foundation, and then what you lay it with will be tested by fire. So if you build with hay and it gets burnt up, well, yes, you just got through the fire, but that's it. Versus whether you built with precious stones, and that stands the test of time. So for someone like me, that upside related to accountability has been truly encouraging and aspirational. And I think God has designed it specifically for that.